Chapter 3, Section 4, Space Telescopes. We're going to go in order here, basically from the longest wavelength, lowest energy waves, up to the highest. Now, radio astronomy typically can be done very well from the Earth because radio waves cut through our atmosphere very easily. So we're going to kind of skip that. I don't know of any super important, you know, again, radio astronomy, we saw in the last section where it's done all over the world in single dishes like FAST and arrays in West Virginia and Chile and so forth. So anyway, we're going to go straight to the microwave part of the spectrum. And one of the, and again, now we're talking only about space telescopes, telescopes in orbit, typically around the Earth. COBE was a very important one historically, Cosmic Background Explorer, which was launched in the early 90s. And it took one image that is truly iconic, that blue and pink image you see down there. That's a monumental moment there, because back in the 60s, I guess, when the first proof of the Big Bang theory came about, there was a detection of something called the cosmic microwave background. We'll talk all about this later in the year. And that cosmic microwave background had one problem. It seemed to be exactly the same everywhere they looked in the sky. Now, the problem is that represented the beginning of our universe. And you look at the universe today, and it's not smooth like that at all. We have all of these big clusters of galaxies and giant voids. My point is that you want the baby picture of the universe to look like the mature version that we have today. And so COBE had the sensitivity in that part of the spectrum to produce this image showing, oh, wait, the baby picture isn't smooth. It is sort of clumpy there with higher energy areas, let's say in red, and the lower energy areas and energy density areas in blue. And that matches what we see today. So that was a huge moment that really kind of once and for all showed the validity of the whole Big Bang idea and what we think happened early in the history of our universe. We've had a replacement for that old satellite, COBE. Planck is the newest microwave. I think it's the flagship for microwave astronomy. All right. One area of astronomy that is fascinating and it's really, really cutting edge is infrared astronomy. When you think infrared, you think heat. All right. Now, first of all, infrared has an advantage, just like radio waves, because it's on the longer wavelength into the spectrum. Infrared can penetrate a lot of areas in space that are clouded, shrouded in dust and gas and so forth. So that's important by itself. But when I think of infrared, I basically think, look, these are places that are warm, but they're not glowing. They're not giving off visible light. Okay. So you can't see them well with, let's say, the VLT or the Keck telescopes or the Hubble, but you can see them with infrared. So what are some warm places? Well, how about places where stars are forming, planets are forming? So newborn systems like that are places that are warm, but not necessarily giving off any or much light at this point. So places like that is where you're going to use infrared. Now, how do we study infrared? This is the part that I think is really fascinating. You can do some infrared from mountaintops, most famously Subaru in Japan. Subaru is a Japanese word, but the Subaru telescope is in Hawaii, next to the Keck's, literally like next door to the Keck telescope. So that is an 8-meter wide scope, I believe. And but it's limited in the portion, I believe, of the infrared that can actually make it through our atmosphere. So what do? You can get even higher up than that. So SOFIA is a really amazing aircraft where it has sort of a bay door that opens and they can study infrared, from tens of thousands of feet from the stratosphere, essentially. So that's pretty amazing. We'll see a picture of that in just a moment. But of course, the best solution of all is to go into space. And so currently in 2018, our flagship is still the Spitzer. named after a man named Lyman Spitzer, who first sort of proposed space telescopes. Spitzer's been amazing. I mean, it's been an incredible telescope, but everybody's excited about the next generation, the James Webb Space Telescope. The James Webb Space Telescope. Unfortunately, I've had to change the notes here like half a dozen times, because every time I give this lecture, they push the year back. Right now, I've got it at 2020. It just keeps getting pushed back, but it just shows you what an important mission is, because they have to get it right. They have to get it right. James Webb is going to be the flagship for astronomy, let alone infrared astronomy. There's Subaru that I mentioned. Excuse me. Alexa, stop. All right, so there's Subaru next to the Keck on top of Mauna Kea. Giant, giant telescope. There's Sophia. Pretty neat. I know somebody that was on our trip, Eileen from Oklahoma, she got to go on that, one of the astronomers on my Chile trip. And maybe I'll get to do that sometime as well. That's a really neat one, where they take educators up and let them fly around there and see what they're the research that they're conducting. The James Webb, that's what it's going to look like. And again, it doesn't look like your typical telescope, because it's not. It is infrared. So we call it the successor to the Hubble based on its importance, not based on the fact that it's directly the same kind. I don't know if it's ever going to have sort of the public affection that the Hubble has had, to be honest. But it's huge. The Hubble mirror is 2.4 meters wide. This one's 6.5 meters. That's a lot of extra surface area. So it's absolutely huge. There are the mirrors, by the way, working on them in Houston, Texas there. So anyway, here's a portion of the sky. You're looking at Orion on the left with visible light. You look at it and all of a sudden infrared, all of this gas and dust shows up that normally you could not see. So that's part of the strength of infrared there, seeing stuff like that. Visible light, well, gee, which space telescope am I going to pick? Oh, yeah, how about the Hubble Space Telescope? First launched in 1990. It famously did not work properly. It was blurry. They had a problem called spherical aberration, meaning the mirror was the wrong shape. By the width of a human hair, they had ground it to the wrong shape. It was a huge embarrassment for NASA at the time. But it also led to one of their great triumphs, because in 1993, they sent up another mission. Of course, that's a huge waste of money and certainly a risk at six or seven astronauts risking their lives to go up and go on another mission. But anyway, the mission in 93 was incredible. Story Musgrave was the astronaut, I think, that was doing the spacewalk that repaired the Hubble. They basically gave it some contact lenses. And then, of course, the rest is history, because the rest of the 90s, it was just revolutionary. Absolutely revolutionary. There's a great mock-up of it at the Kennedy Space Center. You can get a feel that this thing is absolutely huge. It's like the size of a large bus. Sadly, they did their final repair mission in 2009. That was one of the last missions of the space shuttle. And that's it. I mean, they gave it new batteries and gyroscopes and stuff like that, and they've just been crossing their fingers ever since. But here we are 9 years later, and it's still the flagship out there. So look at this. These pictures, I just happened to come across this on Google and saw these beautiful images in a museum. So here you are, and, you know, it's just classic. It just fits in with something like this from, you know, classical time period or the Renaissance or whatever, because it just represents the best of our age. And the pictures are just that beautiful, you know, that they're just, I don't know, it's just amazing. And seeing that, I mean, that's why I started astronomy class. A lot of people don't know that, but I started teaching in 94, right when it was brand new. And by 97, all these images were coming out, and I just said, hey, let's start a class in astronomy. This is where it's at. And so that's been 20 years ago, 21 years ago. Anyway, you go past, now we're going up to the higher energy. We're at the high energy end of the electromagnetic spectrum. And the first thing you come to, of course, is ultraviolet. What is ultraviolet used for? Well, for example, really, really hot stars, like hot young stars like the Pleiades cluster, those stars actually peak, their energy output peaks in the ultraviolet. So you might use it for that. I don't hear a lot about ultraviolet astronomy, to be honest with you. Of course, you know some ultraviolet reaches the earth because you can get a sunburn at the beach from that ultraviolet. So you can do it here from earth. For example, high altitude balloons, you can attach equipment and do some ultraviolet astronomy. We have a high altitude balloon project called Project Aquila at our school. We've done that since 2010, and maybe we could do something with ultraviolet sometime. Anyway, currently the Hubble is capable, I believe, of doing some ultraviolet, and there's one called Galax. This is not an area that honestly I know that much about because I really don't see that much coming out of ultraviolet astronomy compared to, let's say, infrared. All right, or compared to this next one, X-ray astronomy. Now you're getting up to some really super high energy stuff. Now you know that it doesn't reach the ground because if you went to the beach at night, you know, I said you'd get a sunburn in the day. If you went to the beach at night and you were getting hit by X-rays, you would, you know, see your bones and stuff like that. Also, we would all die probably because that would be really, really bad. This high energy, we'd have to live, you know, underground and so forth. So life on Earth didn't have to worry about X-rays. That's what allowed life to flourish the way it has, at least on the surface of the Earth, because our atmosphere blocks all X-rays. That's a good thing. But of course, then to study X-rays, guess what? You have to go above that atmosphere. So we have to have satellites. What kinds of things produce X-rays in space? Well, something pretty darn violent, okay? It has to be something huge. So example, stuff that's getting shredded around a black hole. Now remember, X-rays don't come from black holes themselves. X-rays can't escape a black hole. But the stuff that's swirling around what's called the accretion disk, that stuff can heat up to a point where it gives off X-rays. And that's one of the ways that we first confirmed a black hole, Cygnus X-1, that X standing for X-rays. This is a very different kind of design. A normal mirror will not work. So they have this sort of like a tube, like a bunch of concentric circles that the X-rays come in and they're able to focus them. They are able to do it, but it's a very different looking design. It's not your typical mirror. And the Chandra, I'm going to probably hack the name here, named after Subramanian Chandrasekhar, who was an Indian-American physicist. Back at the time of Einstein, actually worked with Einstein, I think, at one point. But Chandra, named after him, it's been a workhorse. This has been the flagship for X-ray astronomy. Look at this, for a long, long time, since the 1990s. So it has been absolutely an amazing mission. This just shows what Chandra looks like. In the upper right there, I'm not going to play that, but it just shows that a regular mirror doesn't reflect X-rays. So you'd have a totally different design. And then finally, we get to the highest energy of all, gamma rays. Gamma rays simply can't be focused. So I don't even know if it's fair to call these gamma ray telescopes. Personally, I don't think that word quite fits here. They're more like detectors, kind of like a Geiger counter or something. Either you get hit by a gamma ray or you don't, and they can see what direction it's coming from. We only get about one of these per day from space. And again, I think that's a pretty good thing. You don't want your planet hit by a bunch of powerful gamma rays. Again, it's nasty, nasty stuff. But when we do get hit, what we're really interested in are what are called GRBs or gamma ray burst. When I first started teaching, this was a huge mystery in astronomy. Now we have not one, but two answers to this question of what are GRBs. And it turns out there are two different ways we think that GRBs, gamma ray bursts, are created. And the first way, it's pretty awesome, a hypernova. When the most massive of the most massive of the most massive stars blow up, you don't just call it a supernova now, we call it a hypernova. And we think that moment is enough to possibly give off a burst of gamma rays. Versus colliding neutron stars. If you have two neutron stars in a binary and they're swirling around each other, I know we haven't got to neutron stars yet, but they're super incredibly unimaginably dense. And if those things collide, that would be enough to give off a burst of gamma rays. But they give it off at a different rate, a different frequency than the hypernova. So they think there's sort of two flavors there, two different things happening in space to produce them. The classic one that first really made a lot of discoveries in gamma rays was the Compton Gamma Ray Observatory, which eventually fell into the Pacific Ocean. It was replaced by the Fermi, it was replaced by the Swift, in 2004. There you see a couple animation of a couple binaries. And then now the Fermi, there it is, named after Enrico Fermi. That is our flagship in gamma ray astronomy. So we've got all our bases covered in space, space telescopes covered.